CTV National News with Lisa LaFlamme.
Good evening. We begin tonight with our exclusive one-on-one today with the Prime Minister, in which he defends a deficit that goes far deeper than previously projected or promised. No pretense of austerity from this Liberal government. $26.6 billion in the red, up from the $19.8 billion estimated in the last federal budget.
It's just an ongoing approach.
And with the perils and politics of a minority mandate, Justin Trudeau is still in campaign mode, selling Canadians on the value of spending despite a massive financial shortfall.
We made a decision to invest in communities, to invest in Canadians. We've seen over a million new jobs created over the past 4 years. We've seen 900,000 people lifted out of poverty, including 300,000 kids. And we're projected to have the second best growth in the G7 right now. And we have the lowest debt as a proportion of our GDP in the G7. We're on a good track, and it's because we've kept investing in people.
So to those economists who today said there doesn't appear to be that sort of cautious moving forward from the government, given the fact that we may be coming into rocky territory.
I actually disagree with those economists, because we've been very careful to keep our debt low as a share of the size of our economy so that we have the firepower necessary if we do hit rough waters.
You hit rough waters in October when you ended in a minority government. You started in a majority government. What do you point to for the slide from majority to minority?
Oh, I think we're looking at a rise of populism around the world. We're looking at challenges in electoral circumstances. We're looking at lessons that we learned as a government, thinking about how we can really dig in on the substance of what we're doing and reassure Canadians. Because it's not just about a PR exercise to make people say, oh, the government's doing well. It's, no, are your institutions serving you? Is the government doing the kinds of things that is going to help you in the future? Do you have confidence in your future, in your community, in your kids? Those sort of messages are really important, and that's very much what we have to focus on.
Well, for sure, one thing everybody noticed was certainly moving Jody Wilson-Raybould from her role in justice. And I wonder if that may have started the slide. If you feel any regret for the way that all unfolded.
Obviously, the way it unfolded meant that we were, you know, very much focused on internal matters and sort of liberal internal disagreements at a time where Canadians expect us to be focused on them. So that absolutely takes away from the focus we have to have, any government has to have, on serving Canadians. So anything that distracts from that needs to be moved through as quickly as possible so you can get back to the work of working for Canadians.
As you have now with premiers across this
pretty
country.
Pretty much every province,
but do
yes.
you see that as having been one of the greatest hurdles right now in a minority government, is that you need to build stronger alliances with premiers? Who do you think is your best ally?
Probably Premier Horgan, perhaps on many issues, Premier Legault. Others, I really like, obviously, Dwight Ball. You know what? There are lots of great allies out there across the Federation.
But when it comes to who will replace Andrew Scheer, I wonder if you have reached out to Rona Ambrose with some kind of ambassadorship.
I'm not going to try and influence outcomes one way or another. Rona has done incredible work for us as part of the negotiation of NAFTA.
So that was just a rumor then?
You know what? There are always interesting conversations going on, but often they are not generated from me in my office.
On China, though, the opposition has been pretty clear. They don't feel you're doing enough to help with the two Canadians, Michael Spavor and Michael Kovrig, detained. I wonder why you don't just jump on a plane to Beijing instead of asking Donald Trump to do your talking for you.
You think I should speak directly with President Xi?
Why not?
Well, I did. about 6 months ago, and we got
nothing's happened.
There have been positive movements behind the scenes. We got a new ambassador in who's doing a great job. We continue to advocate for it regularly. Keeping these Canadians safe, getting them home, is something we've engaged all our partners around the world on, so that when just about any of our friends or partners around the world sits down with a meeting with China, they bring up the case of the Canadians incarcerated or detained.
And you're confident they do that?
I know they do that, because we keep getting feedback that that the Chinese officials are less than pleased when allies are bringing this up to them, and they say, no, this is an internal issue. We continue to advocate every day for the release of these Canadians, and we will continue to.
So where do you think they're at right now? Where is that at for the families
Unfortunately, these situations sometimes take a very long time, and we've been very successful in many consular situations over the past 4 years, and it's just constant engagement, looking for opportunities, taking it seriously and diligently, and not being overly political about it, just being sort of strategic and conscientious about it.
I have to ask, the NATO summit, obviously one of the headlines that came out of that was you being caught on an open mic. For someone who's been raised on camera, how did you let that happen?
Oh, I think it was a camera at the far end of the room that had a very good mic on it, but you know, a lot has been sort of made of that incident. At the same time, you know, a few days later, we closed NAFTA.
How awkward was your conversation with Donald Trump? I mean, he called you two-faced.
I've had many conversations with Donald Trump over the years.
And
conversations with him since. And our relationship is constructive. We get things done.
Yet I know you never wanted to be a polarizing prime minister. That would be nobody's goal. What do you see as a resolution for the new year to try to bring this country together?
I know that Canadians expect in 2020 that they have a government that is engaged and listening and looking to collaborate and looking to work constructively with people, and that's very much my resolution. You know, what are we doing tangibly and concretely to make Canadians' lives better? That's what we're going to be focused on next year.